Would you please stand for our opening hymn, number 366, O God, Our Help in Ages Past. Service. I lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. We meet in the presence of God. We commit ourselves to work in penitence and faith for reconciliation between the nations, that all people may, together, live in freedom, justice, and peace. We pray for all who in bereavement, disability and pain continue to suffer the consequences of fighting and terror. We remember with thanksgiving and sorrow those whose lives in world wars and conflicts past and present have been given and taken away. And we come to our wreath laying. Let us remember before God those who have died for their country in war, those whom we knew and whose memory we treasure. all who have lived and died in the service of mankind.
Thou shalt not grow old as that our left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn.
At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
It is my honour in this act of remembrance to recount the names of the men of Elmstead Market who gave their lives in the First World War. They are as such. O. A. Ellis Allen, Albert A. Baker, Ernest A. Baker, Ernest Barker, Samuel Barker, Frederick W. Bloomfield, Arthur Carrington, Mark Cole, G. Oliver Crackley, John H. Day, Leonard Dowsett, Albert E. German, John B. Hawkins, C. Clifford Howard, Ernest E. Howard, Arthur G. Marshall, Percy E. McKinley, Frederick W. Norfolk, William J. Simmons, Charles Smith, Bert Smith, Joseph Taylor, Morris Taylor, Arthur E. Vince, Herbert G. Bess, Henry G. Wayland, Walter Watson, and Arthur W. Wendt. They gave their lives for king and country during the Great War, 1914 to 1918. Greater love hath no man, and he lays down his life for his friends.
We observe the 2 minutes silence. The prayer of remembrance. Ever living God, we remember those whom you have gathered from the storm of war into the peace of your presence. May that same peace calm our fears, bring justice to all peoples, and establish harmony among the nations, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please remain standing for our next hymn, number 328, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. Please be seated. Good morning and welcome to our service for Remembrance Sunday. And a warm welcome to Michael, who's up in the organ loft. He's accompanying us this morning. Thank you, Michael. And thanks to Rick and Emma for being the voices at the beginning of our service. And for Peter for reading the list of the war departed. Our notices are, of course, in the bulletin, but does anybody wish to add to them this morning? No. And the remainder of our service begins with the prayer of penitence. Let us confess to God the sins and shortcomings of the world, its pride, its selfishness, its greed, its evil divisions and hatreds. Let us confess our share in what is wrong and our failure to seek and establish that peace which God wills for his children. And we say together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned. We have not loved you with our whole heart.
Ourselves.
In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are
and
shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May Almighty God have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please remain seated for our readings.
The first reading is Psalm 98. O sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained him victory. The Lord has made known his victory. He has revealed his vindication in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills sing together for joy. Let the presence of the Lord, for he is coming to judge the and at the presence of the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. The second reading is from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 1, verses 5 to 19. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, he said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be, and what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places, famines and plagues. And there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons. And you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance. For I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand for our next hymn, number 139, "For the Healing of the Nations." Father, we pray that you would give true wisdom and Holy Spirit power to your servant Beth as she brings us your word this morning. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
Amen. Tucked away in a cupboard in the house in which I was growing up during the Second World War, there was a battered pocket watch. A very ordinary watch. It had a quite plain face, and it had a case which was made of base metal, not something that would have raised a lot of money in any auction. And we were told that this had belonged to our Uncle Tom, who was my father's eldest brother, who had been killed in the First World War. Quite why my father, who was one of the younger children in a family of 13, had come to be the custodian of this watch, or indeed how it had come back, or indeed why he'd ever been in the army, because he was a minor, and as such he was in a reserved occupation even when conscription came in 1916. And it certainly hadn't saved his life, because if the case was battered because it had been hit by a bullet, he certainly had died. Now, you might be wondering why, with all these questions that curious children might like to know the answer to, we didn't ask them. Well, I had a kind of schizophrenic Second World War, because at the time we were living in the house as a family which belonged to my grandfather and he was a very powerful figure within it. Now, during the First World War, he'd been a conscientious objector, and so he had spent more than 3 years in Wormwood Scrubs and Leicester Jail. So now you know all about me, don't you? And that war was a subject that we were not supposed to talk about. He had been a conscientious objector because he was a Methodist local preacher, and he believed absolutely, thou shalt not kill. And therefore, although he often boasted that he had several of his brothers who had fought in the First World War, he had chosen a different route. But that meant that we couldn't ask the questions about Uncle Tom because it was such a sensitive subject, and we would be told by our parents not to go down that route. Now, when the Commonwealth Graves Commission put all their records online some 20 years or so ago, I then learned that, in fact, my Uncle Tom he'd enlisted in the Durham Light Infantry, and he'd been killed at Ypres, and that his body was in the railway cemetery at Ypres. Now, even later, I took my brother Tom on a weekend, a short break in Bruges, and we took the opportunity to go first of all to the battlefields of Passchendaele, which even in peacetime were terrifying. We went to the wonderful museum in Ypres, where it was one of those where, as you go in, they give you an identity, and there are various times as you're going round that you can actually stop to find out what was happening to your character. And that was a very moving experience. I had known that my Uncle Tom died in March 1916. And in that museum, I learned that the British Army was so set in its ways during the First World War that it was only in March 1916 that they allowed our soldiers to wear tin helmets, because it wasn't very British to do that. And I thought, well, I hope my uncle didn't die of a head wound before he had a tin helmet. And we went also to the shop in Ypres, where if you go in, they will look up where your relative is buried and give you a photograph. Now, I knew where this relative was buried, but it happened that the proprietor of the shop was actually very upset because he hadn't photographed the Commonwealth graves in this particular cemetery. But he said, come back tomorrow and I'll take you there. Well, we weren't able to do that because our mini break meant we had to be on Eurostar the following morning. So he did say to me, well, if you're serious and you would like a picture of this, I will get you one. But when you get home, he gave me his email address and said, when you get home, send me an email and I will send you a picture. And this he duly did. And then I discovered from what he sent me that my uncle was buried in a grave with two other soldiers. So I emailed to ask why this would have happened. And he said it happened when the bodies were so mangled that you couldn't actually separate one from another. And I have never ceased to be glad that my grandmother didn't know that. But what was also interesting to me after this, my brother, who by chance, actually happened to have the same name, Thomas William Jackson, told me in the years that remained to him that Remembrance Sunday meant something different to him from what it had done before. Because when he heard the names read out, as Peter has already done for us today, it made him, because he knew what had happened to his namesake, it made it real to him in a way that it would, had never been real before. He saw them as people like him, who in different circumstances had made choices which had cost them their lives. Now, we don't know very much about the people whose names are inscribed on our war memorial. We don't know what made them join up. There are all sorts of reasons. They may have been filled with a great spirit of patriotism and wanted to serve their king and country. They might have believed, well, it's all going to be over by Christmas, which is what people did think, and we won't be away for long. It'll be a bit of a lark. Well, it's an excuse to get out of Elmstead, isn't it? Or wherever else they were living. And so, we don't know what caused them to go, what their motives were, and we don't know whether at any point they became disillusioned and afraid. Were they just longing for their homes as they died far from them? When Chris Tolley enlisted me to help him to find out more about these people whose names are on our memorial, both inside the church and on the one outside that used to be in the Methodist church, he discovered some interesting things. We were amazed to discover, for instance, that two of them had died in Gaza, in Israel, and were buried there, not on the battlefields of Europe at all. And that a number of them were no longer resident in Elmstead. Their parents were, but many of them had married, they'd moved away, they'd found jobs elsewhere. There were, of course, people who were still in the village, but not by any means all of them. And we also discovered that there were two terrible months in 1917, March and April, where a number of people died in this, who had links with this village. And you can only imagine, can't you, what that must have felt like in a community so much smaller than it is now. The grief that must have been felt. If you have been watching local news on television recently, you will know that Luke East has been discovering and recording the memories of people who are now 98. Who are veterans of the Second World War. And they want to get this written down before it is too late. And that made me think that it won't be very long before people like me, who knew survivors of the First World War, veterans of the First World War, and who knew at first hand what was happening in the Second World War, we will not be alive to to give living memories of these. And so it has made me think about the people in my own family. Some I didn't know. My uncles, Tom, I've talked about, and James, who was married to my aunt, and a great uncle, Henry, all died. They, of course, died before I was born, so I have no memories of them. But I do remember great Uncle Joe, who had been what they then called shell-shocked, and who bore the scars, and he was never quite as you might have expected him to be. There were church wardens, Fred in the Southampton, who had been in the Royal Flying Corps in the First World War and told fascinating and terrifying stories of how they had to patch up the planes in between their missions before they risked their lives again. There was Herbert, another church warden in Wolverston, who had lost his leg on his 19th birthday. And when he fell in church one day and I was trying unsuccessfully to help him up, I had the temerity to ask, "Does it hurt, Herbert?" And he said, "Every day." And there was his fellow church warden, Willie, who had been gassed and whose rasping breath told you and took him back every day to those days. And in the Second World War, I had three cousins who were killed. I had three uncles who survived. One of them, many Atlantic crossings in the Merchant Navy, one fighting in Burma, and one imprisoned in a prisoner of war camp in Poland after the Battle of Anzio. I had a cousin who was a rear gunner, a tail end Charlie, one of the most dangerous positions to have, who survived and was awarded the Distinguished Flying Medal because only officers get the cross. And I remember civilians I knew who died. And in later wars, I remember contemporaries who went to fight in Suez. My brother-in-law fought in Korea and got a head wound, which gave him blinding headaches for the rest of his short life. And Matthew Dietz, formerly of this congregation, who fought in Iraq. People we know who fought in Afghanistan. I don't know personally anybody who fought in the Falklands, but there have been all these wars since where people have gone and they've lost their lives or they have survived and have to live with the memories and the consequences. And I'm sure that when I'm recalling these, all of you will be able to sit here and record people that you have known and give thanks for them and regret that they ever had to be in that position. Our gospel reading today is one of those where Jesus makes it clear that actually there will be suffering and danger in the world because we as people, we may long for the peace and harmony. We may, as we've just sung in that wonderful hymn, look for a world which is different, where we can live together. But unfortunately, as human beings, desire and greed and the lust for power really get in the way. And how often we are reminded of this in the daily news that we hear today from Ukraine. But his message is not one of despair, but of hope. By your endurance, he says, by your suffering, you will gain your souls. He sees with the clearest of eyes what we are capable of, both in destruction and in building a better world. When these young men that we honor today went to fight, as I said, their motives might have been different, but they did believe that they were going to build a better world as they went to serve their king and country. And you've got to remember that that was the motivation not only of the soldiers on our side. As Wilfred Owen, in his marvelous poem, Strange Meeting, where he meets, after death, a German compatriot. He introduces himself, "I am the enemy you killed, my friend." Many, many young people on all sides of conflict die in wars. I once found myself at a formal meal sitting next to someone whose place, you know, the place card in front indicated that he had won the Victoria Cross. Now, I the way you have to make conversation, and I said to him, "I don't think I've ever met anyone as brave as you before." And he said to me, "On the battlefield, the difference between bravery and foolhardiness is a very fine line." And he said, "You know, on the battlefield, the adrenaline kicks in, and so does the instinct for survival." And so I'm not sure whether I was brave or not. But, he went on to say, "What I do on a day-to-day basis in my civilian life is much more demanding, requires me to be much more courageous." And it turned out that he was devoting his civilian life to working with young men in the southern areas of London, who were often violent, dangerous, disillusioned, and very angry. And he said, "Every day when I go to work, I am being more brave than I was on the battlefield." But of course, you don't get the VC for that. Now, I think he was probably being very modest about his bravery on the battlefield. But his words have always stayed with me. Most of us have not been required to put our lives at risk for our country. And I sincerely hope that the young people of today will not have to do that either. But if we are followers of Christ, we are all required to do for our faith what he requires. You remember that chilling piece of the Bible, which always makes me examine myself very carefully, where he divides people into sheep and goats. and then says, when they ask him, but we didn't visit you in prison, we didn't give you food when you didn't have it, we didn't look after you, he says, the fact that you did it to the least of these my children meant you did it unto me. And that is a demand that is made of all of us in our lives. Today, we honour the memory of these men who went and gave their lives for the service of others. And we have to realise that one of the ways to honour them, and as members of this congregation, we need to resolve that we will be better Christian soldiers, taking Christ's message of peace and love and truth to the world. And in doing that, we may be saying to these people whom we honour today, what you did was not in vain. Amen.
Amen. And now Morag will lead us in our prayers.
Let us pray for all who suffer as a result of conflict and ask that God may give us peace. For the servicemen and women who have died in the violence of war, each one remembered by and known to God. May God give peace. God give peace. For those who love them in death as in life, offering the distress of our grief and the sadness of our loss, may God give peace. God give peace. For all members of the armed forces who are in danger this day around the world, remembering family, friends, and all who pray for their safe return, may God give peace.
God give peace.
For civilian women, children, and men whose lives are disfigured by war or terror, calling to mind in penitence the anger and hatreds of humanity, may God give peace.
God give peace.
For peacemakers and peacekeepers who seek to keep the world secure and free, may God give peace.
God
give peace. For all who bear the burden and privilege of leadership, political, military, and religious, asking for gifts of wisdom and resolve in the search of reconciliation and peace, may God give peace.
God give peace.
O God of truth and justice, we hold before you those whose memory we cherish and those whose names we will never know. Help us to lift our eyes above the torment of this broken world and grant us the grace to pray for those who wish us harm. As we honour the past, may we put our faith in your future, for you are the source of life and hope, now and always. Amen.
Amen.
Now we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Those who wish to are invited to come forward to light candles as a symbol of hope for the future before we sing our next hymn. Look at it. Thank you. please stand to sing our next hymn 288, King of Glory, King of Peace. Standing for our act of commitment. Let us commit ourselves to responsible living and faithful service. Will you strive for all that makes for peace?
We will.
Will you seek to heal the wounds of war?
We will.
Will you work for a just future for all humanity?
We will.
Merciful God, we offer to you the fears in us that have not yet been cast out by love. May we accept the hope you have placed in the hearts of all people and live lives of justice, courage, and mercy through Jesus Christ, our risen Redeemer. Amen. Amen. And we sing our penultimate hymn, 82, Christ Whose Glory Fills the Sky.
Light embodied.
this Remembrance Sunday, we sing together the National Anthem, which is 177 in our books. We sing all three verses. Into the world in peace, be of good courage, hold fast that which is good, render to no one evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, honor everyone, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit, and the blessing of God be with us all. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Christ.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you. I've never seen a remembrance service.